So good morning, everybody, to the first session, to the first lecture of the morning. So I'll speak about today I speak about the theorems by Schur and by Schur's theorem and then Radot's theorem. Radot was a student of Schur, and as Professor Adhikari said, in Ramsey theory, which was born in the 1930s, before that there were two Ramsey-type theorems, the one by Hilbert in 1892, and the one by Schur in 1916. And so the motivation of Schur was about Fermat's theorem. So Fermat, take an exponent at least 3, then the equation, say xn plus yn equals zn, has no solution. In the positive integers. I will use this notation for the positive integers. Okay, and so as you know, this was, it remained an open problem for almost 300 years. Proved only in 1983 by Wiles, and 1985 to fix a little gap by Wiles and Taylor. Yeah, 90, yeah. Thank you. So before that, so it was.
Oh, the sound.
So maybe I should put it like this. No. Like this. Better. Yeah, it's better. Thank you. Okay. And so in Dixon, in 1909. He wondered whether maybe this equation mod p has no solution for some p. Given n, maybe for some p there is no solution, but this turned out not to be the case. So, given n, so for any sufficiently large prime, prime number p, the equation xn plus yn congruent to zn. Now let me put an equality. Has solutions. Does have solution. Mod p. A non-trivial solution, of course. So that was the theorem. And then Schur, the motivation of Schur was to provide a combinatorial, a simple combinatorial proof of this result. And he came up with this theorem, This is the combinatorial argument. So the theorem is that given any finite coloring of the positive integers, there must be a monochromatic solution to the equation x plus y equals z. Or let me write x plus y minus z equals zero. So there is no n here, but there is this combinatorial statement. And then Schur proves that statement and deduces Dixon's theorem. So let me, so the purpose, one of the purpose today is to prove this, this theorem. So let me check if I didn't forget anything. Okay, so here is a finitary version, equivalent finitary version. So theorem, still sure, of course, this is the same theorem. Given a positive integer r, so there exists a largest integer SR. There exists a largest integer n equals SR such that, when you speak about the threshold, you either want the threshold for existence or 1 minus is a threshold for non-existence, such that the integer interval admits an R coloring without any monochromatic solution to that equation. So admits an R coloring without any monochromatic solution to that equation. So let's look at a few examples. Say you have one color. What is S1? Well, you see, if you color this thing, then there is no solution to that equation. 1 plus 1 minus 1 is not zero. However, of course, if you try to color that with one color, then you are stuck because 1 plus 1 minus 2 is 0. So it means you cannot go up to 2. So the answer is S1 is 1. What about two colors? So say this is your first color, this is your second color. I can put 1 in the first color. Now 1 plus 1 is 2, so I cannot put 2 here. So I'm obliged to put 2 in the second color. Now 2 plus 2 is 4, so I cannot put 4 here. I'm obliged to put 4 here. Now 1 plus 3 is 4, so I cannot put 3 here, so I should put it here, okay? And now I try to put 5 somewhere, but 1 plus 4 is 5, so 5 is not there. And 2 plus 3 is 5, so 5 is not there. And so this is a two-coloring of 1, 2, 3, 4 without monochromatic solution to the equation, but I cannot put 5. That's the only solution. So the result is that.
Let's try again three colors. Then, in fact, you could start with that. And five, you cannot put here, so you put it here. Now you can go up to, you are not allowed to go up to 10. So let's go up to 9. And now 10, I cannot put it here, so let's say I put it here. I cannot put 11 here, neither here, so I should put 11, 12 here, and 13 is here. And that's good enough. There is no monochromatic solution to the equation in this three coloring. But 14, I cannot put it in the first row, in the second row, and in the third row. So, and in fact, this coloring is all is essentially unique. You can put 7 here, or you can put 7 here, or you can put 7 here. These are the only three solutions, maximal solutions. So in fact, you have S3 equals 13. What about the next numbers? Well, Schur, in his theorem, proved that. R factorials E, so this is the basis of a natural logarithm. And in fact, of course, they differ widely when R is large. So for L, R equals 4, this gives you S4 is at least 40. And in fact, the way you reach 40, a four coloring of 1 up to 40 without a monochromatic solution to the thing, is you repeat that. You put in the fourth color 14 up to 27, and you repeat symmetrically. That's the way he gets this bound. But the actual number was found by computer, by Baumert in 1961, and the actual value is 44. And it's not as naive as, that. There are about 300 different colorings which reach this bound, and up to 45 you cannot do it. Until 2017, what was known essentially was that for R equals 5. And then, by a huge, massive computation with a SAT solver, Earl proved that this is the actual value. And nothing else is known. I don't remember S6. Maybe there is a coloring up to 536, which works, but and something with 7. But this is essentially what is known for numbers which were born more than a century ago. So let's prove. I wanted to give. To give the original proof of Schur, which is very, very nice, and gives actually this upper bound here. There is a shorter proof using the Ramsey numbers. So just so recall, so given R colors, the Ramsey number R3. So this is the Ramsey number 3, 3, 3, little r times, is the smallest, so let me call that n, is the smallest positive integer n such that if the complete graph is the edges of the complete graph with n vertices are colored. The trees for a sub triangle. There must be a triangle, so there is a monochromatic triangle. Okay, so this was the existence of this number were proven in Professor Adhikari's lectures, in the first lecture, and let me, for example, R13 is 3. Professor Adhikari showed that for two colors, the minimum is 6. For three colors, this is 17. This is very nice. There is a construction with finite fields. This is due to Greenwood and Gleason in 1955. And essentially, that's all is known already for four colors. Then this was proven by Chung. And this is what is known since this was obtained in the 80s by Fan Chung. And this was in 2002 by by a few people, and that's it. In fact, the conjecture, well, there is a conjecture that this is the actual value. So this is in the 80s, this is maybe 1983 by Chung, and this is maybe a construction in 2002 or something. And the conjecture is that the actual value is 51. Okay, so a proof of Schur's theorem. The claim is that SR, this number SR exists and is bounded above by the Ramsey number for triangles. And this will prove the existence of the Schur number. This will prove the theorem. Okay, and so the proof is very nice. So let N be this Ramsey number. Okay, and now let's say delta be an R coloring of that interval. So you see, this is. So to show, there is a monochromatic solution to Schur's equation in that interval, of course. And this will prove, if we can show that, so this will prove the claim. All right. It means, I can, if I want to avoid any monochromatic solution, then I cannot go up to n minus 1. I should go up to n minus 2 maximum. So this will prove the claim. Another construction is very, very nice. So say Kn say is a complete graph. Is a complete graph on the set of vertices yn. Okay. Now, let us deduce from this arbitrary R-coloring an R-coloring of the edges of the complete graph as follows. So it will be delta 2 from the set of edges to those R colors. And the construction is very nice, very simple. So take an arbitrary edge. So with so the vertices are A and B. Okay. So this is your two vertices. This is your edge. And the color given by delta 2 is simply the difference. So delta 2 of that edge, you define it as being B minus A. And since A is at least 1, so this is a number in N1, N minus 1. Sorry. You use delta. You take the color. It makes sense since B minus A belongs to that interval, right? B and A are here, so B minus A is at most N minus 1. You have this given coloring. Where is it? Here is the given coloring of that interval. So delta 2 of that edge is the original coloring of B minus A, okay? So now, since N was the Ramsey number, then there is a delta 2 monochromatic triangle in that complete graph. So let's draw that triangle. It's monochromatic under delta 2. And the color of that edge is simply delta of B minus A. Here the color is delta of C minus B. Here the color is delta of C minus A. And this is monochromatic, so delta of C minus A is delta of C minus B, and it's the same color, right? So, but now, now you see C minus A. So, but the key point is that C minus A is the sum of C minus B plus C minus A. And these are three monochromatic numbers. This is your X, this is your Y, this is your Z. Huh?
Y is B minus A.
Yes. Thank you. Here we are. And this is a monochromatic solution, and that proves the claim. Very simple, very beautiful. But Shor's proof is also very, very beautiful. And of course, here we use Ramsey number, which were only born in 1930. If you have the opportunity to read Shor's proof, for example, in Sierpinski's book or elsewhere, it's very, very nice too. Originally, I wanted to give it today, but it would have taken a few minutes more. A few minutes more, by the way. Oh, I still have 1 hour to go. Huh? That's a lot of time. Okay, so let's see. Number theory. I think it's called elementary number theory, I don't remember. Yes, so you see here, we treated the equation x plus y minus z equals zero. And we, for any finite coloring, we cannot avoid a monochromatic solution. What about that solution? So here again, you cannot avoid a monochromatic solution under any finite coloring because this is an arithmetic progression. Any solution to that is an arithmetic progression. Z minus X is Y minus Z. And by van der Verden theorem, you are done. You cannot avoid monochromatic solution. What about X plus Y minus 3Z, for instance? So here it's completely different. In fact, there is a four coloring of the positive integer so that there is no monochromatic solution to that equation. So it's completely different, and we would like to understand what's the difference. Here we can avoid mono solution. Here we cannot avoid monochromatic solution. So what happens? And the answer was given by Rado. But did I want to say something else? Yeah. So let's introduce this definition by Richard Rado in the 30s. So take a polynomial in n variable over z, say not constant. Then you say that the equation f equals zero, like that, is said to be regular if precisely you cannot avoid monochromatic solution under any coloring. If for any finite coloring, here we stick with positive integers. You can do more general. You can go to Z, you can go to Q, you can go to whatever you want. These are different problems. We stick with positive integer. For any finite coloring, then there must be a monochromatic solution to it. Okay? So with this definition, so x plus y minus z equals zero, x plus y minus 2z equals zero are regular. This is van der Verden for length 3 arithmetic progression. This is true. Those are regular, and I claim that this is not regular. And these are equations of degree one. Let me just mention one, and tomorrow we'll mention another one. Here's a widely open problem about the Pythagorean triples. Is the quadratic equation x squared plus y squared minus z squared equals zero regular? I'll say a bit more about it tomorrow. This is widely open since decades. What is known since just 1 or 2 years, no more, is that for any two coloring of the positive integers, you cannot avoid a monochromatic solution. So, but for three colorings, it's open. And so here is the theorem by Rado, which gives a complete characterization of those homogeneous polynomial of those polynomial of degree one, homogeneous of degree one, so that this equation is regular. So theorem, Rado in the 30s. So let say f of x1 xn be given by c1 x1 plus cn xn with c1 cn non-zero integers. Okay, so then the equation f equals zero is a regular if and only if, and there is a complete characterization, if and only if some subset of the coefficients sum up to zero. So if and only if there is a non-empty subset of the indices such that the sum of the coefficients over I vanishes. This is if and only if. Now let's check our three equations. Here the coefficients are 1, 1, minus 1. And so 1 and minus 1 sum up to 0. So this satisfies Rado condition. 1 plus 1 minus 2 is 0. So this is OK. And here you combine however you wish 1, 1, and minus 3. You will not reach 0. So this does not satisfy Rado's condition. And this is why, thanks to Rado, we know this equation is not regular. Yeah, it's not regular. By the and in fact, Rado's proof shows that, in fact, there is a four coloring for which you cannot avoid monochromatic solutions. Okay, this is an abridged version. I will show later a more general version for a system of linear equation, not only one equation, but a system of a homogeneous system of linear equations. I will give that later on. And okay, let's try to start the proof. So say the easier part, this is combinatorial. Is that one. So so assume we will prove the contraposé, I don't know how to say it in English. La contraposée in French. So assume assume the condition of Rado is not satisfied. For every non-empty subset of the indices. So, and so our task now is to give a coloring which will completely avoid monochromatic solution. The equation f equals zero is not regular. And so what we want is a special coloring which will avoid so wanted a finite coloring of the positive integer avoiding monochromatic solutions to that equation. And the idea is as follows. So take a prime number, a large prime number, so that these things will never be zero mod p for any subset of indices. So these are non-zero integers, so of course you can find a large p, so that this will never be zero mod p for any non-empty subset of the indices. Voilà, here we are. Okay, and now we define the following coloring. So let delta be the be the p minus one coloring defined as follows. You take an integer, positive integer. You remove. You look at how many, what the largest power of p dividing n, m, and a is not congruent to zero mod p. So you look at the decomposition. And then you define delta m, you completely ignore the powers of p there. Completely ignore them. It will be the same as delta a. And a is not zero mod p. You simply take the class there. It's class, it's a non-zero class. Let me put a star. Okay, so that's the coloring. And the claim is that there is no monochromatic solution to C1 X1 plus Cn Xn monochromatic solution, say X1 Xn in n plus n to that equation. So assume the contrary. And this is my solution. Okay, so first of all, you may assume that they are coprime globally by removing the GCD. And it will still be a monochromatic solution, in fact, because if you remove a P, it will not change something. And if we remove a D, which is coprime to P, it's invertible there, so it will still be a monochromatic solution, okay? And also may assume, so they cannot be all divisible by P. So up to renumbering, say, may assume X1 up to Xm not congruent to zero mod P. And the other ones, the remaining ones, congruent to zero mod p. Okay, so look at that and reduce mod p. So the tail because of that will vanish mod p, and what you get is that c1 x1 plus cm, this is an m xm, is congruent to zero mod p. Yeah, of course, I should say when. Okay, so we have that. And now, since this is a monochromatic solution, in fact, so this is x1 bar because there is no x1 is co-prime to p, so this is x1, x1 bar. In fact, in the non-zero integers mod p, then if you look at this equation, you get c1 plus cm times x1 bar equals zero. Okay, but this is not zero. And this implies that, well, why? And so this implies that C1 plus Cm is congruent to zero mod P. Sorry? The key, yeah, the key word here is hidden there. No, but it doesn't matter. We have this. We have this, and then this is a contradiction. This is a contradiction because here you have a subset of the CI whose sum is zero mod p. You see, if you have two numbers which are monochromatic, one might be zero mod p and the other not. Because if it's zero mod p, it is divisible by some power of p. But to get the color, you have to remove that power. You know? You know? So that's the point. That's the point. You may have two integers which have the same color under delta. One is zero mod p and the other one is not. That's the point. Yes, 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 yes. Yeah, this is a coloring. Okay. And now, for instance, look at that equation here. I claimed there was a four coloring with no monochromatic solution to it, because here you can take p equals five. That works, I hope. Yeah, 1 plus 1, 1 minus 3. No subsum is 0 mod 5. So you can take that coloring with p equals 5, and this gives you a 4 coloring without any monochromatic solution. Okay. Okay, so we are done with this easy part. But easy but clever, because you need to find a clever coloring which will avoid a monochromatic solution. So, okay, and now say, now we need to prove the, for the converse. There is not enough time to cover the converse, so we will do it tomorrow, but we will need, let me recall, we will need van der Verden. So let me recall results that were given in Professor Adhikari's, yeah, Professor Adhikari's lectures. So theorem. So van der Verden
1927. So let KR be positive integers. Then there exists a positive integer WKR. So that for any R coloring of the integers from 1 to n, there is a k-term arithmetic progression which is monochromatic. And then just shortly afterwards, Brouwer gave the following strengthening, which was also mentioned in Professor Adhikari's talks, and he got it because he wanted to solve a conjecture by Schur. Take KRS, positive integers. So there exists n, say n KRS, so that for any R coloring of the integers from 1 to n, there is a monochromatic sequence of the following form. So say A plus D, A plus 2D, A plus KD. So far, this is a K-term arithmetic progression. And then you can also put, you have this extra parameter S, you can, for example, S equals 1 or whatever, SD will be of the same color as these guys. So there is a monochromatic sequence constituted of a k-term AP plus any arbitrary given multiple of the difference of that arithmetic progression. So the key to Brouwer, so, you know, if you ask somebody to prove that as an exercise, it will not be easy at all. In fact, Schur wanted to prove something like that. In fact, Schur wanted to prove van der Weerden theorem, and he couldn't. So this is a tough exercise, but nevertheless, if you indicate what integer you might work, then the exercise becomes much easier. So you proceed by induction on the number of colors as always. And so take NKRS, assuming that you know already how to deal with R minus 1 colors for any K and S. So it should be something like, you know, so assuming you already know that number. So you multiply that by K, and you take the van der Weerden number
of that length, so this is huge, still with R colors. And it's not yet finished. You multiply by S. So maybe it should be K plus one or this number plus one, or, but I think it's correct. So this should work. And in fact, just this should do the job. And in fact, if you know that, well, you know, it means, well, okay, so you R color this huge interval. You know there is a monochromatic solution. There is an arithmetic progression. And when you know that, then the exercise is not as, it won't take you 20 years to. So let's see. Okay, so so 5 minutes remains. I will prove the converse tomorrow. So I will not recall. We will use this. So I will not recall it tomorrow. Let me just do a first trivial step of the proof for the remaining 1 hour time. So assume that Radow's condition is satisfied. There exists some non-empty subset of the indices such that the sum of the coefficients over the subsequence is actually zero. So let delta be an arbitrary finite coloring of the positive integers. And what we want to show a monochromatic solution. We want to show that there must be a monochromatic solution to the equation F equals zero. So you see, up to renumbering of the CIs, we may assume that C1 plus CM is zero for some. We know the CIs are not zero, so for psi m, for some m, like that. So if m equals n, i.e. C1 plus Cn equals zero, then in this case, to get a monochromatic solution is completely trivial. Because C1 plus Cn is simply the evaluation of our polynomial in 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. And this is your mono solution, of course, under your arbitrary coloring delta. So this is your mono solution, your monochromatic solution to the equation. And so this case is completely trivial. And so, Now assume m strictly less than n, and let's call C the sum of the coefficients up to n. And so here we may assume, as we have just seen, that C in fact so is not zero. And in fact, we may further assume that C is positive by changing all signs. Okay, so in fact, now you have, so C is the sum of all the coefficients, but this M was something so that up to M is zero, and so in fact, so the first M terms contribute to nothing. So this is what we have in the situation, and this number is a positive integer. Okay, and then tomorrow I will start from this point, and we will finish the proof of the converse of Rado's theorem, and it will be much tougher because it will use this difficult theorem. Okay, so thank you.